Welcome to the Low Carb Athlete Podcast, where we focus on discussing topics to help you burn fat, optimize health, and improve performance in life and sports. Transform the whole you from the inside out with the holistic method. Let's dive in. Here's your host, Debbie Potts.
Hey guys, I have a great, fun guest on the show today to dive into one of my favorite subjects, metabolic efficiency. As I started using heart rate monitors, I sound old, but way back in, before 2000, year 2000, I started doing Ironmans in 2001 and started metabolic testing 2005 with New Leaf metabolic testing cart. And in between that, I learned a lot from Sally Edwards using heart zone training back in the 90s. And then we were using that for coaching triathletes with the heart rate monitor, using heart zone training and Danskin triathlon training programs. So I've been around the block, I realized, talking to Casey today. I am turning 50 this November and just doing everything I can to be my best self and be healthy, happy, vibrant, and really practice what I preach. And Casey and I connected. I was on his show, his podcast, and we really had a fun time. And he started metabolic testing in 2007, being a personal trainer and metabolic testing and all sorts of things that kind of similar to me, but years after I started. And it's really fun to talk shop with another trainer and coach who understands that there's so much more to burning fat, losing weight, than just exercising more and working out harder and pushing yourself and then cutting back on what you're eating, or, you know, maybe you're going low carb, but going too low carb. So we dive into all sorts of fun topics today. I just love this call we had, and hopefully we'll connect again in the future, podcasting together. But let's go over some of the main topics we dive into. I know New Leaf metabolic efficiency testing was one of my favorite things to dive into with Casey, as I haven't been able to do it for years since he, you'll learn why. But we talk about what type of exercise he recommends to lose weight, how to burn fat, what surprising things can help us be more effective at burning fat, and before that, why do we even want to burn fat rather than just lose weight? As I always say, burn fat instead of losing weight, because I don't want you to lose weight. I don't want you to lose your muscles. We're working on rebuilding those muscles, especially as we age, and women, we lose those muscle building hormones as we go through menopause. And there's so much we need to do to build muscle up, especially that chronic stress that breaks our muscles down. So losing fat weight is our ultimate goal. So Casey and I dive into that. But why is he on my show? Well, he has a podcast and he's a trainer, and he started being a personal trainer in 2007. He ran the metabolic testing program for a large gym and oversaw 13 programs in the West region. He has multiple certifications as personal trainer, lifestyle coach, performance enhancement specialist. With his nutrition coaching certification, he specializes now in low carbohydrate lifestyles, including ketogenic and carnivore diets. He has helped thousands of clients over 14 years learn how to achieve their best lifestyle through movement, lifestyle management, and proper diet. He lives in South Jordan, Utah, with his wife, Bethany, and their two dogs and cats. In his free time, he loves to bike, cycle, play hockey, and paddleboard. So obviously those are at different times of the year, maybe not, but we have a great time chatting about all things burning fat. So if you have any questions, just drop a note to me in the link in the show notes, or just head to debbiepotts.net and I can answer your questions. I get those emails from the website directly to my inbox and I respond to them. So feel free to ask any questions that you have and see if I can help you be your best self and live your best life, the second half of your life. So let's work on not just performance this year, but look at what's ahead of you, your future self, longevity. As I am striving to be fit and healthy on the inside out, as I hope you are as well. So let's work on learning how to be fat adapted athletes, but also let's work on our health in the future selves. What you'll be doing when you're age 70, 80. Hey, that'll be me in Italy hiking the hills in Tuscany and Amalfi Coast. So I'm doing everything I can to be healthy. So join the journey being a fit and healthy athlete. All right, let's bring on Casey.
Okay, gang, I have a fellow personal trainer, coach, and podcaster on my podcast today to talk all things training, fueling, and performing for the low-carb athlete. So Casey came on my show, is on your show a few weeks ago, and I've got you back. So thank you for joining me.
Absolutely, Debbie. Thank you so much for having me on. We've had so much positive feedback about your episode on our show. So thank you for your content. And yeah, it's been great.
Good. Love learning from you. I think it's just great to partner up with everyone that has similar passion and purpose and on a mission to just get people fit and healthy from inside out, right?
I agree. Especially in today's day and age, it's just so, so important to get the message out. And it's such a fun grassroots movement that's coming up from the ground. And the more people that talk about it and share it around, the better.
Yeah, I think so too. It's just, you know, always surround yourself with positive people and you just can grow from that. So let's talk about your story. You're a personal trainer, you work Lifetime Fitness, and you know, how'd you get into a podcast and talk about health and low carb and
instead
of training?
Yeah, so that? So I started with a big gym corporation, you mentioned Lifetime Fitness. I started with them in 2007. At the time I was actually in college studying architecture, but I joined the gym and I didn't really know anything about personal training. I just wanted a place to train in the off season for cycle racing. And I started watching the personal trainers and started thinking like, boy, that looks really fun. Lifetime Fitness at the time was selling heart rate monitors. And I had, this is how much of a nerd I am. When I was 18 years old, my parents bought me a TV VCR combo to take down to college. And I returned it so I could buy a Polar S210 heart rate monitor. And I tracked my heart rate and learned how to use it. And it's something that I'd been using for a long time. And the personal trainers were using it there at Lifetime Fitness. So I marched my, 22-year-old bud into the office and just asked what I needed to do to get a job there. And they told me the certification that I needed. And I went and got it. And it was back in March of 2007. I was hired there and worked there for 13 years.
Wow. So did they use Polar monitors or were they using for workouts on the screen?
Initially they were using just Polar heart rate monitors. And, they only carried like one or two models and they slowly expanded. The heart rate monitors that they used had programming features that none of the trainers knew how to use that I had been using for a long time. And so to set up zones, program workouts, like I was able to do that for people where, none of the other trainers knew how to do that. And so that was something that I kind of specialized in and moved into. You and I both use the New Leaf analyzers.
That's what I want to talk about next, my favorite subject.
initially it was just Polar. Over time, we added Garmin, Suunto, all kinds of different brands. And then, they started adding like the screen that would show everybody, what zone they were in, almost like an Orange Theory style. Just kind of using that over the years.
Well, that's what I wondered, because I know I did heart zone training early on with Sally Edwards, 25 years ago.
Oh, cool.
And we started doing that, but it's over the years. I know at my own gym, when I own Fitness Forward Studio, we had my zone the last few years using it. And it was always just from, using heart zone training in spin class and training people for so many years. It was so nice to finally be able to have what I always wanted when I taught spin class, to have it on the screen. Then I stopped teaching, but it's such a great way to train people by heart rate, to know what exactly high intensity interval training is, or how to do a low heart rate workout, and then how to do like a rest-based training. Cause I see people, doing intervals. And even when I was running this morning, it's just, okay, I run till this heart rate, then I'm going to walk till I get to this heart rate recovered. And so what did you learn from doing heart rate training early on?
That was such a really well-explained point. There's areas that you can train in that accomplish different things, and you can do high intensity intervals and they do this. And then the low intensity work does that, but hardly anybody knows about it. So they spend all this time in the middle where
the black hole.
Yes, exactly. I'm wasting myself. I'm sweating. I'm breathing hard. I'm not burning fat. I'm not improving my high end, and I'm not improving my efficiency on the low end. It's like you need to have a purpose for your workouts, and different intensities accomplish different things. And so with heart rate training, that's just such a great way to teach people. It's almost like, you know, you have your, you know, speedometer on your car, but now you have a speed limit. You know what to do to accomplish what you want to do. And then it makes it a lot more clear.
Well, so true. And I think so many people assume that they're in that, you know, the fat burning range, and they're thinking harder the better, and they're just depleting their body and creating more stress rather than a good beneficial workout for your health. So it is that kind of Maffetone max aerobic function heart rate, doing that low and slow, which is way lower than most people run at. So it's always hard to figure out where your heart rate is guessing. And the same with everything we talk about is test and not guess. And heart rate training, I think, is a big part of that. Cause to be at say 130 heart rate to run, your heart rate's probably going to go whoop, and you have to walk, and it's just frustrating for people. Or if you're doing intervals.
Yep, totally. But if you understand what the purpose is and what the goal is and why you're doing it, then people are a little bit more motivated to actually stick with the program, even if it feels too easy or too hard or whatever. If they know what the purpose is, that helps them to stay motivated. I've always wondered if like the calorie tracking number on a treadmill just screwed everybody for the rest of their life. Once they put that on there, everybody's just focusing on calories. The best way to burn a bunch of calories is to take your heart rate up too high and keep it there for a really long time, which again, doesn't accomplish the purpose that people think.
Mm-hmm. Well, I used to watch people in the gym all the time before I moved last year, before COVID, a year ago today. We're recording this March 12th, 2020. Yep. We stopped going to the gym.
Yep.
And before that, I'd see people on the elliptical and the bikes, and they're there every morning, but it'd just be driving me nuts. Like, here I am lifting weights, doing a hard workout, and then they're just sitting there.
Yep.
So it's really, some people, what's like the Goldilocks effect? You know, you're going too slow, too low of heart rate, or too high. There are people just like hammering on the Stairmaster, holding on, you know, locked elbows for an hour, just sweating to death. And then there's the people that were barely even like, why bother workout?
So
like, that's why I like people to have that biofeedback, wearing a heart rate monitor, same with, you know, wearing an Oura ring, sleeping and whatever, just more data you can collect to figure out how to perform your best in your workouts and recovery, right?
Yeah, I love that you talk about that concept, that Goldilocks effect. I think that's a really simple way for people to understand, you know, you need a purpose for what you're doing.
Yeah. Well, you keep saying the word purpose, and that's a big word in my world. Is I always think, you know, what I've learned this from Todd Durkin in my mastermind years ago as a fitness coach and business owner, that, you know, define your purpose and what is your passion, what's your mission, and how you're going to create impact. And you can take that purpose to your workout to start with. It's like, you should have a purpose to that workout. If I'm going to go step out today for a run or a bike ride or workout weights, what is the purpose of that workout? What's your why? And that's with all over life. But what does that mean to you? What does the word purpose mean?
I love that. I always tell my clients, you should be able to stop me at any point and ask me to my face, why am I doing this? Yes. Why am I doing this exercise with this many reps, with this many sets at this tempo, in this order? Why am I doing this? What does this have to do with me getting to my goal? I am here. I want to be there. Maybe I want to lose fat. Maybe I'm training for a marathon. Maybe I want to grab my grandkids off the couch or something. Like, and reconnecting, this is why we're doing this exercise, because you want this end goal. I think that's so important. And I love how you said that. Like, it's important to have that in your workouts also. And it's important to have that in life. You need to consider, like, what do you truly want to get out of life, so that then you can take the behavioral steps to help you get to that end goal.
Yeah. And that's what I learned too in my mastermind business group, that you can apply this to all areas of life, but writing your big five for the week ahead, looking at your 90-day wonder, we'd say, and look at your annual plan, and really, you know, breaking it up, not just looking at, here's what I want to achieve in 2021, but okay, that's your big goal. And then maybe you have a big, hairy, audacious goal, the bag, call it, and then go smaller. And then I would go, okay, week to week, what am I going to do this week that's going to get me to that big goal? So setting five goals up for the week ahead, the 30-day plan, your quarterly plan, and then annual plan. But I think you have to set your intentions in all areas of life, if it's nutrition or my sleep or, you know, working on having more joy and laughter in your life and hugging people.
I love it. I can't wait for that.
I know. So virtual hugs are exactly. done. Enough of that. So what, like your purpose as a coach, how has that changed your way of things that you've learned, you know, talking about heart rate training and giving your clients more of a purpose to the workout? And then how did you use that with New Leaf? If we can get into metabolic efficiency as a popular subject.
Yeah, of course, I'd love to. So it's just like you said, you can have a workout or you can train. Mm-hmm. A workout is I'm going to go to the gym and I'm going to lift some stuff or I'm going to run around or jump around or something. And that I'm going to sweat. And that's a workout, but that's not a training plan. A training plan is, again, trying to get to that end goal. And so when we put somebody on a training plan, we're a lot more mindful about taking that long view than breaking it down into like you said, like a monthly and a weekly and a daily kind of what behaviors are going to get you to that final destination, because that destination seems like it's so far along, you need to break down that goal. And New Leaf really helped us because we could actually measure respiration from people. And there's so much information that you can unlock from the breath. I find it just endlessly fascinating. And so one of the things that a lot of people don't know is that the more you breathe, the more air that's coming in and out of your body is a direct indicator, direct correlation with how many calories your body's burning. So as we're sitting here, we're not, you know, doing a whole lot, just kind of hanging out. So we're not breathing a lot. And that just means we're not using a ton of energy. You know, we're using some, but just not a lot. And if, you know, we were to go out on a run and run really fast, and you would definitely outrun me and I'd be huffing and puffing and you'd be way up the road on my hands and knees at some point, breathing very heavily, that means I'm using more calories. So if I know, again, how much breath is coming in and out, you know, that's what we talk about. We talk about like VO2 or VO2 max. We know how many calories somebody burns. And so that's really important. But the cool thing about the analyzers that we were using is they went one step further, where they didn't just break down the amount of air that was coming in and out. They were measuring oxygen and carbon dioxide, and how those two things exchange in the body tells us a whole other subset of information that tells us whether the calories that we're burning are coming from fat or whether the calories we're burning are coming from carbohydrates or sugar. And that, as you very well know, is so, so, so critical for somebody to get the results they want. Again, whether they're training for an event, they're an athlete, they're a low carb athlete like yourself, or whether they just want to lose fat. If you're not working out according, again, like you said, to the purpose of what you want, you won't be able to achieve that goal. And you're going to waste a lot of time and energy chasing the wrong thing.
Yeah, that's so true. It's just, what is your purpose of your workout? And then getting the data to figure out more specifically what you need from each workout. And then you can figure out as a coach too, what are the workouts that are best for you based on these results? Kind of a snapshot of what your metabolism is right now based on your lifestyle. Your stressors is a huge part of it, I found. Testing people, but also like how you're training now, is it making you more carb dependent or are you improving that metabolic efficiency to burn fat as your main fuel source?
Yeah, so that's right.
If we could back up though, if you could, cause I kind of jumped into New Leaf. People might not know what New Leaf is and it just turns my stomach. I must say again, just every time that word comes up, I'm like,
no.
If people don't know, I'll just throw in, I used to test for years until New Leaf was bought by a company called Lifetime Fitness. So when they took that away and I was just wanting to focus on that full time and they stole it from us.
Devastating.
So. I've been devastated since. So go ahead. What is New Leaf?
That's funny. So New Leaf was a company that made those metabolic analyzers and they're actually not unique. There's other companies that do it. I know Woodway has an analyzer that they produce. Panoe, I think, is one that I've heard of. I think it's from Europe. They produce one. There's even one here locally in Salt Lake City, Utah named Core. And they do similar things. Where they're analyzing breath and air and able to determine not only that total amount of calories burned and VO2 max and things like that, but also what we call the respiratory quotient, which is the ratio or difference, RQ. Yep. Sometimes referred to as a respiratory exchange ratio or RER also. Mm-hmm. And it's just the difference between the oxygen and carbon dioxide that, that somebody's burning. And that, again, will help show people what intensity they need to train at to be able to burn fat or increase performance on the top end.
Yeah. So I have my test from years ago when I was like, I was training low carb before we knew it was low carb, you know, just doing low carb and eating and fasted workouts. But the way I trained by heart rate was mainly how I did it. And I would did Maffetone training, the lower heart rate, because I worked with Mark Allen and I did heart rate training back in forever ago, but started training for Ironmans in 2001 and was training by heart rate. I sound really old now, but, and then 2003 or four, I started training with Mark Allen and we did Maffetone, the max aerobic function heart rate, the 180 minus your age. And once we got the new leaf, I started correlating, you know, each test that I did on myself or clients and then put it with that math heart rate. And it was really odd because it was, I was listening to a podcast with Phil Maffetone the other day on how he created that. He was on Peter Attia's web podcast and how the formula, and it was really interesting how he figured it out, tweaking, you know, this formula, because 220 minus your age doesn't equal your max heart rate. Same with, you know, 1 pound of body fat doesn't equal 3,500 calories. It's just a number. But anyways, the testing, I was going to say, I still save this in a snapshot somewhere in my computer that I got up to max aerobic fat burning up to like 163 heart rate, my anaerobic threshold, just from training so many years on endurance volume, but I was training always by heart rate, building that aerobic engine and going by my metabolic efficiency testing numbers. And it was so crazy to me that just the one time I had that test, like, oh my gosh, I kept burning such a high percentage of fat way up to 160s. Wow. And just the truth that it, it does work, expands that range.
Debbie, you are so ahead of the curve. I didn't figure that stuff out until so long. When we started, you know, doing the heart rate training, that was just the training. We didn't, nobody knew about nutrition. We didn't know nutrition could change that at all. It wasn't until 2012 when I heard a call from Bob Sebahar, who that he was saying he was changing people's nutrition to be a little bit more low carbohydrate, more fat based. And his athletes were eating bacon and cream and crushing Ironmans. And I'm drinking like gallons of Cytomax and Goos and all that crap. Sorry if you wanted them as a show sponsor, they're not going to be on your show anymore. But
I think
it'd
work.
And my energy was up and down and all over the place. And I was bonking all the time. I needed a nap every single day. And this guy's talking about like, no, my athletes have perfect energy. They perform at very high levels for really long times, not burning sugar. They're burning fat, stored fat energy that's already on the body, ready to go, ready to be burned. It's just hanging out. It's actually weighing the athletes down. Yeah. Why not access it as fuel? And it blew my mind and completely changed my life. It was such an important piece to put together with the training, with the diet, the importance of the diet with that training is crazy.
Yeah, you do have to match your nutrition and your exercise together. But it's also, as we talked before, about those external stressors. And I figured out that with metabolic testing people, I think I said on your show, that I would test someone in the morning versus testing someone. I always remembered she has struggled with losing weight and exercised all the time and could never lose weight. Well, I tested her after work and her, I'm sure, you know, knowing what I know now about stress hormones and cortisol, she was just like not burning any fat at all after work. Wow. She sat in traffic. Work was stressful. Sat in traffic in Seattle, probably, you know, 45 minutes to go 5 miles. Wow. And then you're just come to a test to get your body to exercise to where you burn fat. Well, stress is on, your blood sugar is going to go up. And so it's really interesting to go back and kind of process everything I was doing back then. And then it's like, oh, it totally makes sense when you look at you know, adrenal fatigue, insulin resistance, all the stuff with the stress hormones, how it impacts your ability to burn fat. Even if you're training at that max aerobic function heart rate, if you're totally stressed, whacked out, I'm sure that if we could test people nowadays, was why I was upset I couldn't continue testing people, what would happen? and do all these like biohacks on it.
It's so important to understand. And just like so many other things, the context of our lives today is so different than it was as we were evolving for, you know, thousands and thousands and thousands of years. Those stress hormones are so important. They help us run away. They help us be alert. They help us hunt for food when we need to. And that activation, like the cortisol, is really good in that situation. We need that. But then we also need the time when stress comes down and is low and we've eaten and everything's cool and we don't have a lot else going on. And so we just, in that state of where we have evolved for so long, there wasn't as much like chronic stress, like every single day, day to day, low level stress, poor sleep, too many screens, not enough fresh air and sunlight and all these amazing things that we need and we evolved with. You take those out, you elevate your cortisol to this weird kind of mid level where it's like, it's just always kind of high. And yeah, you get dysfunction with that. People have a metabolism that leans toward burning sugar. They are, because of that, they're up and down all day on that blood sugar roller coaster. And they're probably eating and snacking way too much. It's just, it's like I said, just in today's day and age, we've taken the context of how these hormones have worked for us for so many, you know, thousands of years. And we just, our lifestyle is not set up to have good, healthy, you know, metabolism, good, healthy hormone balance. And so getting that imbalance is so important. I'm so glad that's something that you talk about.
So when is the last time you were doing functional lab testing or functional metabolic testing with the New Leaf? How long ago did you stop?
A year ago yesterday.
Did you figure, go ahead. I just want to know if you learned stuff, like when you were doing it most recently, were you picking up anything, clues as that, the impacts of chronic stress or the nutrition and people's test results?
Yeah, that's a great question. So, you know, with respiratory virus, the metabolic program was shut down before the gym was shut down. Mm-hmm. We learned maybe a week before the gym shut down that the metabolic program was not able to continue. I don't know if it's even back up online. I don't know if trainers are, you know, standing next to treadmills where people are breathing concentrated breath. I don't know. I'm not sure. But yes, I've learned a lot over the years. One of the correlations that I noticed, when we were doing the test, we would ask people to tell us on a scale of 1 to 10, how they were feeling while they were doing the test. And we were watching the data on the screen and then asking the person subjectively how they felt. And we noticed almost every time that when somebody was at a 5 out of 10 for difficulty, that was pretty close to where their maximum fat burn would be. And so, you know, if somebody is not able to access those machines and get into a gym, that's the best way I can tell somebody, you know, if they're not using Maffetone zones, you can also kind of go by feel and see where you feel on a scale of 1 to 10. And you can pretty much bet you'll be pretty darn close when you're at about a 5 out of 10 at difficulty that you're at your maximum fat burn. And also that your anaerobic threshold is going to be right around an 8 for most people. Again, that's subjective. It's not objective, but I think it's a really nice way that if somebody's wearing a heart rate monitor, they can at least get an idea of what that zone is doing to them. Another thing that I learned, I have to say, we're talking a lot about what we call like an active test where somebody was getting ramped up on a treadmill or they were on a bike and we were increasing their wattage by a certain amount every few minutes. We would also do the same thing resting. So a resting metabolic rate test is super interesting. Yeah. We would take somebody, put them in a dark room, hopefully in the morning, like you mentioned earlier, before everything was getting too stressful. And we would just have them chill out for about 20 minutes and just breathe into the same analyzer. And this was measuring somebody's baseline metabolic rate. How many calories does it take for you to sit in this chair and not do anything? It's your brain function and breathing and, you know, your heart is beating, your kidneys are working. That requires quite a bit of energy. And so we would measure that with people. And we noticed that the person that was on a calorie restricted diet, that was counting their calories and trying to keep their calories low, they were usually doing a ton of that black death zone cardio, running way too much or doing way too much cardio. They, you know, again, dieting too much. They had the most cravings. They felt cold all the time. Sometimes they got lightheaded as they went from seated to standing. They would almost always have a low metabolic rate. meaning their bodies weren't burning very many calories as they were just sitting there. And we would tell people, like, to increase this, you need to do the right kinds of exercise, like lifting weights and doing cardio in the proper zones and the proper ratios. And we would also tell people that they needed to usually eat more calories, eat more nutrient-dense food so that that number would come back up. And the thing that I learned in the last few years that took me a really long time to wrap my brain around is I would have people come in and they would say they were on either a low carb diet or maybe they were doing intermittent fasting. And I would, you know, do the test on them and their metabolic rate would be hundreds of calories higher than what it should have been. And I would say, wow, this is great. Like your metabolic rate is higher than it should be. So you need to eat this many calories every single day or your metabolism is going to tank. And these people would look at me and they would say, I can't eat 2,700 calories a day. That's unless do you want me to eat like Twinkies and donuts and like drink soda? Like I can't get there. I'm so stuffed on less calories. And it took me a long time to understand. And Dr. Jason Fung was somebody who really helped me in my understanding of knowing that eating less calories is vastly different than, you know, not eating, fasting for a time, accessing stored fat energy to the point that you don't necessarily need to make up tons and tons of calories in your nutrition as long as you're burning stored fat. That took me a very long time to wrap my brain around.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I love his information and their research, and they're always so good. You know, cutting edge of everything. But it's just interesting to kind of test people resting when they are intermittent fasting and then tweaking with their diet, bring them back in, because there isn't one size fits all approach and can really customize what they are eating. And even more, if you can do a food sensitivity test, you know, look at their metabolic typing diet, which, you know, slower fast oxidizer. And then you look at, say you do their genetic SNP as DNA fit and really look at their nutrition genetics part of it and ancestry background, and then take them in there. I mean, that'd be really
I love
info, but fun.
I love that. And even when I use the word fasting, like what is fasting? It's such a loaded word that I really have to work on making sure I'm really clear when we explain it. Fasting for somebody might be they just haven't eaten in 12 hours. Or maybe somebody's doing extended fasting and they're doing days. Like that gets into a whole new world. But you're right. There's no one size fits all, and there's so many great assessments out there, like you mentioned, that help to validate that.
Well, and plus the FASTER study that was done on a bunch of men, and they were doing a keto diet for a year. And Ben Greenfield was one of them, and that's the only real study of people doing low carb ketogenic diet on a treadmill. They had run like for, I don't know, 2-3 hours, I forget what it was. People can look up the FASTER study, but you know, it's not on women. And I've learned, you know, a lot since Dr. Stacey Sims' book, Roar, Women Are Not Small Men. And as she pointed out, you know, there's not, if you look at a lot of the studies, they're not on women because women have, who are menstrual cycles still, their hormones are always changing. And so it's hard to get a good study done on women all with the same cycle. It's not going to really happen unless they all live together for a year. But it'd be interesting doing the metabolic testing to see kind of even more customized based for females and female athletes, how to figure out their fat burning. And I had a great podcast just came out with Dr. Mindy about, you know, timing, she's what awesome. Days a month for your fasting for women and how you can do more carbohydrates the week before your cycle begins. And it's just a fascinating information that's coming out. But if you can kind of, you know, test that on someone individually, I think the easiest way, if you have access to metabolic testing card, which is hard, but yeah. Like, what can you do besides that, you know, do it naturally?
Right. I mean, we brought you on our show so you could tell every woman exactly what to eat and end the discussion and we'd be good and done and we could just move on from it. And you're right. I think it's the more information we have from the most sources that the assessments that you mentioned are so helpful and valuable. And that helps us lead us in the direction. There's also certain guiding principles that we can follow that help us go in that direction. But at the end of the day, it's so individual and people need to play with things and find out what works for them. And what works for you today may or may not work for you in a month or a year. So you have to be willing to pivot and continue to try things to get optimal results.
So how do you train people now that, you know, you don't have access to Metabolic Card, as most people do not? How do you find is the best way for people to get started on trying to burn fat?
Yeah, that's a great question. So our training in particular, when the gym closed down, the way I explain it to people is it's like when March 2020 happened, before that, there was like a game of basketball. And in the game of basketball, there was a court and you had five players on each side and there's a 3-point line and there's certain rules that you have to follow. March of 2020 happens. And now all of the rules of the game are different. Now it's a round court. There's 11 players. Part of it's on ice. I don't know. It's just everything got weird. And what we decided to do at that point is not return back to the big corporate gym. We decided to open up our own business and have a smaller business where we could take care of the people that wanted to, you know, work out from home or work out virtually. They maybe didn't want to go back to the gym. Maybe they weren't going back to that location because that's where all the office buildings were. And now they're at home. So they, you know, dusted off their health riders and their thigh masters and found weird equipment in their basement that's been collecting dust for 30 minutes. And we just kind of thought, again, that the rules of the game were going to change. And so we just pivoted around that. And so we have lots of different ways that we train people. We do train people one-on-one. You know, we finished out our basement into a gym and a Pilates studio, which is great. And we just, you know, do one-on-one sessions down there. We installed medical grade air filters in our house. And so that kind of helps things. We try to be outside as much as possible. And boy, it is amazing. If you would have asked me a year ago, if we could train somebody effectively with maybe a few resistance bands or some suspension straps, or, you know, we've had to get really creative in training people. But that said, we can still have really great workouts with a very minimal amount of equipment. You can take a few things to a park and you can destroy yourself just the way you could in a gym. You just have to be creative and you have to kind of change the way you do things. And so as far as fat burning, we really love the strength training workouts. We also try to provide heart rate zones and cardiovascular workouts using Maffetone zones, or if somebody wants to do, you know, heart rate zones validated by what we talked about earlier, the kind of more subjective, like a rate of perceived exertion or scale of 1 to 10, we can do that. And then the biggest thing that it comes back to, as far as I'm concerned for fat burning, is diet. Diet is so, so important. And people joke about, you know, oh, I put on my COVID-15 and, you know, I'm at home and I'm sitting around, and it's like, maybe, but you can also still eat well. And it's not that difficult. It just requires some, you know, some really good education, and it requires some discipline. And I think the people that stayed with the diet and they're eating low carb and they learned how to cook and they're making meals at home, they're still burning fat. They still have great results and feel really good. And we're able to ride this out with a lower stress load and maintain their body weight. And so those are kind of the core principles that I think we'll always stick with, you know, even after all of this.
And I think it's what you said is stuck with the diet. It's not a diet. It's a, you know, they're eating, the eating plan is not a diet for them. That's why they're able to keep on it. It was a lifestyle habit, and it got to be, that's how they eat. Right. It wasn't some, like, I was hear people like, I tried keto and it didn't work for me. I'm like, well, you know, you just got to find the right macronutrient ratio so it feels good to you, because not everyone needs to add ton of fat. You might just need to add a way more protein and eat vegetables. It's just, to me, it means don't eat crap and eat real food. Nutrient dense whole foods that are in season, local, ideally. So if you're eating the right ratio for foods, it ends up being unintentionally you eat less because you're full and satisfied longer. Your leptin and ghrelin hormones that make you feel hungry and full, they're balanced, and you just start to feel better. So that it's not anything that you're going to just be doing for a month or 2 weeks, and it's sustainable. It's a lifestyle. And that's why I try to make sure people remember.
Yep, that's right. Even just yesterday, I was doing a consultation with somebody through Zoom, and they were telling me that once they tried a low carbohydrate diet, it wasn't sustainable. And I said, okay, that's fair. Like, what? Tell me the components of the diet that you tried. And she said, well, I just didn't like eating 6 times a day. And I was like, why were you eating 6 times a day on a low carbohydrate diet? Like, the whole benefit of a low carbohydrate diet is you may not need to eat that many times.
Yeah.
And she named the name of such and such diet and all these products and supplements and like these small, like, come on. You may have tried a version of a low carbohydrate diet, but it certainly wasn't the one that was best for you.
Yeah. Exactly. I mean, that it is what's best for you based on your body, your bio-individual needs. It isn't everyone follows this exact plan and it's going to work exactly the same for you as it did somebody else.
I love that.
Yeah.
I love that. That's where those great assessments that you mentioned come into play and are so, so important.
Yeah. But, you know, again, we can't really do them, but so we have to work on just paying attention to our own body and our red flags and identifying like when I feel gassy, when I feel bloated, when I feel hungry or I have a headache, and start documenting that and then figure out what you need to adjust. So if you don't want to spend money on, you know, a metabolic testing cart, resting or exercise, and you don't have access to it, or you don't want to do the bunch of lab testing, you can just start paying attention to how you feel, which is so hard for people.
I love that. Yeah. I think so many people are so far removed from what you just said. How do I feel? What type of energy am I showing up to life? Am I excited? Do I share with people? Do I have energy to do all the things I need to do? And I think it's not normal, but I think it's average for most people to think, oh, it's just dad bod. Oh, grandpa just lost his mind. Oh, you gain 10 pounds every year. And yeah, I have to take all these medications. Like that's kind of becoming our average, unfortunately, but it's not normal. Normal is having a great life where you're thriving and feeling good and doing things like you're doing, sharing this great message with other people. And if people could just take a step in that direction, like you said, of just feeling, what does this make me feel? If I eat this food, am I like full for a few hours or do I crash and feel terrible? And putting those things together is so important. I love that.
Yeah. I said something to someone the other day. I saw it came up and I started eating red meat just a couple of years ago and I stopped eating most meat because it grossed me out. Kentucky Fried Chicken probably did it when I was like 12 years old. And I just stopped eating most meat until recently. And took me a while to start eating it. And I'm still kind of selective in what I eat and make sure it's good grass-fed quality source. But someone just, you know, added links here, read this information from a vegan and the bad parts of meat. But I wanted to say, but I feel better when I have more animal protein. It's what works for me.
Yeah.
There's all this research of everyone's got two sides of a coin, but for my body, when I wasn't eating enough meat, everything that I was micronutrient low in, where is that nutrient found? In meat.
Yep.
So it's like
100% agree.
It's what I needed to do to get my nutrients up and feed my mitochondria comes from eating more animal meat and learning how to, you know, eat steak and not be freaking out what it is from and just start enjoying it. And I think so many people, you know, have their different opinions, but again, it goes back to what works for you and your body and your nutrient needs.
Yeah. I love that. I love that.
So what's your take on, you know, nutrition for you guys at home? And do you do intermittent fasting? Do you do fasted workouts? What's your kind of favorite things to do for your health?
Yeah. So for us personally, I'll go back to what we were talking about earlier and talk about purpose. Mm-hmm. What purpose do we want in our life, in our business, and how can we reverse engineer that? So I always try to keep that in mind. And my goal in life is to just enjoy every day. I want to work with my people. I want to, you know, give them really good program designs. And I also want to listen to them. I want to know their story. I want to know how their kids are doing in school. I want to remember what they told me last week. And so my purpose and mission is I really want the best energy that I can possibly have. And I want to have that good energy all day. I don't want to think about how many bottles I want to bring if I want to go on a bike ride. I just want to go on a bike ride. I want a paddleboard. I want to go on a walk. I always get, you know, 10,000 steps a day and usually close to 20,000. I just want good energy for those things. And so for me, our personal diet is very similar. My wife, Bethany, is a Pilates instructor and she does a lot of myofascial release work. And her purpose is very similar. We found the same thing that you found. If we eat a really good amount of red meat, we feel great. And not for any particular reason, just like it just kind of happened. We kind of turned into, we do more of a carnivore style diet. We're not strict by any means. And we generally will do one meal a day. So our meal generally is about 5:30, 6 p.m. Everything's done. Our work is done. I processed whatever podcast I recorded that day. We're taking care of our, finances, whatever. At that point, we like to, sit down and chill out and really get in that kind of rest and digest mode. And so we'll do, generally a meal a day. We do brisket. We'll do really delicious burgers. Every few days, we'll do these like double smash burgers on a cast iron. Mm-hmm. And sometimes we'll have a bun, and sometimes we won't. And sometimes we'll put cheese or, bacon on them. And they're just awesome. We call it burger day around here. We'll do brats or whatever. We just kind of mix it up a little bit, but it ends up being, it sounds like a really restrictive diet because there's not an enormous variety of things that we eat. We generally stick to the same things on a rotation, but we don't feel restricted. We feel like we're fully satiated. We eat until we're totally full. And then we have that energy that we're seeking during the day where we can just go out and do whatever. If I get hungry in the afternoon, it's just that my belly gets a little hungry, but that's about it. I don't feel hangry. I don't get shaky. So that's what we do personally around here. And that has worked out really well.
So do you eat anything before that meal? Are you just like a snack or a shake or something? So are you just pure water until 5 o'clock at night?
it is. I still do coffee in the morning. And with the coffee, I just really enjoyed MCT oil. I'll do about a tablespoon of butter and then I'll do salt. I'll put usually 2 or 3 grams of salt in there, blend that up. That's what I have in the morning. That normally just wakes me up and kind of gets me not like coffee jittery. I think the fat in the coffee helps, give me like an even level of coffee, but that's it. Besides that, I have a little vial of real salt, Redmond Real Salt, my favorite salt company. Yeah. They're here local in Utah as well. Affiliation, but I love them. I know. Yeah. Right. Can't wait to go tour it. But they make little vials of salt.
Love those.
They're great. Aren't they?
I carry them everywhere. Those I'm traveling. Yeah. My purse. It's great.
Yeah. They're great. And I'll kind of shoot that. I'll take, half of it at one time and chase it with water and maybe do it again in the afternoon. If I feel like my hands and feet are getting cold or I want better energy, I'll use the salt for that. But yeah, other than that, all of the workouts we do are fasted. All the bike rides I do are fasted. I find that I'm faster now at age 37 on a fasted workout. It could be middle of the afternoon in the summer. I don't need a bottle of water or anything. I'm faster now than when I was racing bikes on a very high carbohydrate diet, a decade ago. And so I just, that kind of performance, I really enjoy, and I'm not tied to food and nutrition, whether I'm out doing something or not. So that's kind of how that works for us.
Yeah, I think that's great. And, it's that N equals one again, and figuring out what time works. And I always keep saying that what is the length of time that is beneficial, but if I wait too long, that's actually causing a stress. Another source of stress. So it's that fine line, like, if I could go this long, but is that worth it? So it's figuring out, again, paying attention to your body, red flags, going, okay, I haven't eaten this long. I've worked out twice and I've walked. Is that going to be bad for my hormones? So I think that's
right, maybe too much.
Yeah, figure out what is too much. And I think that's easier for us ambitious type A, triple A personalities are driven to go more is better. And I think it's that fine line, like, okay, if I could every day go to 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, not eat or do a, 24 hour fast every day, is that beneficial for me?
Yeah.
And you have to adjust that. Cause if you already have a lot of stressors going on in your life, especially this past year and finances and there's a lot going on all the time, if figuring out what works for you. So just because Casey does that doesn't mean you should do it. Like I know Ben Greenfield does a 24 hour fast every Sunday, but again, men are different than women and whatever your stresses are and your workout. Cause I keep experimenting with that. It's like, okay, I was doing, especially when I was training clients before I moved, before COVID, I'd be Wednesdays, not get home until 3 o'clock. So I wouldn't eat anything all day, but I, lifted weights at 5 a.m. and then I ran with the client and I swam masters and I had 2 clients in the afternoon. And then I finally got home and I'd ate a meal. I'm like, is that good? You know, it's I can, brag that, hey, I haven't eaten and I did this much workout, but is that good for you?
Yeah, that's a great point. And it's just like you said, it's all about that experimentation of finding what works best for you.
Yeah, I know. So stress reduction, what do you guys do in your house to, I know you've got Pilates and a myofascial release. Accessibility there with your wife. That's pretty good.
So nice. It's a bummer that I can't do that for her, but she can do that for me. So I lucked out there.
Yeah.
Stress relief for us. Yeah, that's a really good question. So you mentioned something that I think is so important, and you talked about like ambition and drive. Mm-hmm. And we do feel like for all of our life, we have been striving and pushing and competing. And, you know, a trainer works on, generally speaking, a trainer works on 100% commission. And we're working against 20 or 30 other trainers in the building that are very good. And we're competing with them and just on the grind in 50, 60 hour weeks. You know what that's like. It's crazy. And so my wife and I were just talking the other day that we found in this last year that the opposite of ambition seems to be for us just enough. What is enough? What is the level where everything is okay? It's not too much. It's not zero. And, you know, we're going to be successful, but what does success really mean? And when we go back to that purpose of what we're looking for in our life, we want to enjoy our life. We want to give a great value to our clients. And so we found a nice balance between, you know, we work a few hours a day and we train our people one-on-one, and, you know, that leaves us more time to really address stress in our lives. And so we spend an enormous amount of time outside. Vitamin D is super important to us. We're the weirdos that when it's 35 degrees, if it's sunny, it's laying out weather for sure. And you'll see Bethany out on the porch like a lunatic in a bikini, like absorbing every little bit of vitamin D that she possibly can. Walking has been such a gift this last year. I've been able to walk a lot more. I live in an amazing neighborhood in the outskirts of Salt Lake City, and there's a lake, and just walking around and paying attention to birds and getting to know all the neighborhood cats. And, you know, those kinds of things have been really important to help balance out the drive and ambition. And that's hard if you're a really driven person. And I'm sure you know what that's like as well, but sometimes you need the yin, you need to relax, you need to meditate, you need to be mindful, you need to just take some time for yourself, because otherwise it does get overbalanced. And sometimes that means skipping a workout too. Like, we make these great programs for people and they're a program and that's what we want to do. But if you have a lot of work stress, if today you're feeling achy, like maybe it's better just to go on a light swim or just a walk around the neighborhood. I think that those things can be very restorative.
So that's kind of why the way I coach people now is just more one high-end package, because I can't, knowing what I know now, I can't just give you an exercise program without tracking your heart rate variability, your sleep, you know, getting Oura Ring, doing your Keto Mojo or NutriSense and working on your nutrition. It's the holistic method coaching approach, because I can't just train you and just
I mean, I can.
But I don't feel good about it. And I can't figure out how to write your workouts, especially, you know, I have a couple I'm going to train, they're doing an Ironman and they have stressful jobs and we're going to work on all these other elements and do lab testing too. So it's just one big comprehensive package, because
that's great.
You know, I can't help people be fit and healthy. And that's my thing. It's like, you're not healthy on the inside if you're not doing all those stuff. You're just working out.
I love that. Yeah. I don't think it's possible. I think, you know, the Tim Noakes quote, like you just can't outrun a bad diet. The stress that you mentioned, all of it is so, so critical. So yeah, I love that. I think that is absolutely the best way to go about things.
I guess that's where I got that from. I always say you can't outrun a bad diet. And that must have been from him, because I've interviewed him years ago.
Maybe he stole it from you.
I mean, I told him, right? It's like the Goldilocks effect. I'm like, did I make that up or did someone else?
This is funny, but I interviewed Tim Naiman a few months ago and I asked him what a like typical protein recommendation would be. And he answered word for word the way I recommend protein intake. And I just sat there and like congratulated myself, like, wow, that is what a great recommendation. That's so good.
That's
and it
so
didn't
smart.
Occur to me until after Oh, yeah, I stole this from you a long time ago.
See, there's two things I learned in college that I always remember. Never reinvent the wheel. And do what you do best and hire the rest. That's all I remember from college.
That's just great. That's great. That's great.
So the other thing we just talked about, just what we learned in this past year since, you know, now I realize it is the year anniversary of going into lockdown. Yeah. Is just, I've said since the beginning, especially being a trainer, you know, we work crazy hours, and I was doing that for 25 years. And suddenly I turned 50 this year and I started doing this in college. And I really realized going from, you know, waking up at 4:30 in the morning, I used to wake up at 3:30 in the morning before my down, because I'd be at my gym at 5 a.m. to help people, because then I train them being just crazy hours. And then you have evening shift, and then I have the afternoons open, you know, and it's just ridiculous. And I think what I find that I'm grateful for, and I think a lot of people in the world, that COVID helped us hopefully to slow down, forced you to slow down because you're stuck at home the first few months or longer for some people, that you realize that how busy you are and how we rush from the morning to evening, and we don't ever slow down. And this was the first time in my entire life this past year that I still wake up at 5:30. I'm just an early morning person. I'm more productive in the morning. Afternoon, you know, I'm a mess, and 8 o'clock I'm yawning. So I do best in the morning, but just how different it is for now. I can work out in the morning, and then I start, you know, at 8:30, 9 o'clock, sometimes earlier, with clients and coaching and researching and all my work, which is weird because it's all online now. So I feel the other part is walking more, as you said, and thinking breakfast, lunch, dinner, as I keep saying, is meal time, is not meal time. It means move. It doesn't mean you need to eat. So now I'm like sedentary. But it is just all the gifts that hopefully people realize this past year. What have you gained positively from this year of our pandemic that will be down in history, most insane year probably in a long time, but what positive what did you get out of it?
What a great question. Debbie, I just think this, you're right. This was an opportunity for people, and maybe we'll get another and maybe we won't, but this was our time to stop and slow down and reevaluate and be more mindful and purposeful about what do we truly want? What's important to us and what can fall away? And one of my favorite questions to ask people is, you know, what's one thing that you are really excited to come back online, like an outdoor concert or something? And what's one thing that's fallen away that you actually don't want to bring back in your life? And I think there's a lot of things that we were doing that I don't miss. I think the overall quality of life and relationships is one of the absolute most positive things to come out of this. I think the relationships that we have are fewer, but they're richer. And the ability to linger with somebody and hear somebody in a smaller circle, to take more time, you know, as a couple, we've grown much stronger this year. In this time of so much social inequality and the pandemic and the disease and all the issues we have on our level, on our home level and what we can do and what we can control, this was our time to stop, to slow down, to choose what we wanted, and to design and create whatever possibilities that we wanted and was important to us. And I hope people take some time and recognize that they have the ability to find the positive and to change something and to come out of this stronger and more resilient, because this will end. And you can decide. You have the power. You can do nothing and complain about everything and gain a bunch of weight and not work out and not eat well, or you can do something. There's something you can do, and it, hopefully it's something that brings you more quality and more mindfulness in your life.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's what I've said this entire year, that it's a choice. Your health is a choice, right? We have choices we were given this past year, what you're going to eat at home, if you're going to walk outside down the street and back, if you're going to go to bed on time and not be on social media or watching TV until midnight. Those are choices you make, and it's That's your right. call. And I keep saying again, self-care is self-love. If you love yourself enough, if you care about yourself and your how you want to live your life 20, 30 years from now, you would take responsibility for your own health, take ownership for it. And I've said that for a year. I've written tons of blogs about it. It's like post on social media, but it's just hard for people to figure that out. I don't know why they have such, you know, like TV, media, everything kind of makes them forget about what they have choices of.
That's right.
Health is, that's right. is up to you.
That's right. I love that. I love that. That's so well said.
Well, we're going to run out of time here, but I knew you'd be fun to talk to. So I'm happy to have great. You on the show.
Time's passed so fast.
Yeah. So anything else we didn't get to that you want to throw in before we wrap up?
You know, it was just such a fun conversation. I hope people realize that, you know, there's a lot that we're talking about, but they can start really small. Like it's like in the Tao Te Ching, when it talks about, you know, the journey of 1,000 steps or 1,000 miles starts with a single step. You don't need to have all the answers today. You don't need to have the perfect business. You don't need to have perfect health. You don't need to eat the exact perfect meal just yet, but start taking steps. And if you're confused, this is why people like you are around. Like they can hire you and get some real help. And I hope that people realize that it might not be easy, but it can be simple, and they can start with where they are, and they can make an improvement. There's always something you can do today that's going to make tomorrow better. So I hope people can understand that and take hope and understand that it's not, you don't have to think about the entire journey. Just do something now. Take a step, see what happens.
So true. I mean, I love Dr. Tom O'Brien and his books. He's written a bunch and always says, you know, hit base hits versus trying to get a home run every time, you know, just one at a time. And then also someone, I have a client that I've been coaching. She says, I crawl before I walk and before I can run, just tiny baby steps. And I have to not push her too hard because then she won't do anything. And
that's right.
Get mad at me. So it's like just a little bit at a time or else they fight back and they won't do any of it. So
they won't do any of it.
Let's finish up like 3 things that people can do to take care of themselves today that are baby steps.
Wow. That's great question. There go my dogs. get dogs. They'll make you go walk. Three things. I would say if there was 3 things, the third thing I would say is just move. Find something you love and start moving. Just whatever that is. Eventually we want you to be lifting weights and, you know, working in your heart rate zone. But if you're just starting out, just start moving and find something that you really enjoy. If there were 2 things, the second thing I would say is really address some of those stressors that you mentioned in your life. If you're working too much, if you're staying up too late, if you're not getting outside and getting fresh air, start doing some of those things, because those stressors really, really add up. And you're not going to have nearly the same quality of life that you would if you address those.
Yeah.
And I think the number one thing, it just seems to be the lever that if you pull, most things kind of fall into place, and that's addressing the diet. That is, in my opinion, like finding the right diet for you. For most people, that means having the appropriate level of carbohydrate in your diet to fuel your performance, but not go over the top of that. And being mindful and purposeful around diet, I think, is the number one thing I'd recommend.
The Goldilocks effect, once again, applies to that. What you eat, not too many carbs, not too little carbs, just the right amount to make your body happy.
Yep.
So good. So many great takeaways and great conversation today. Thank you so much, Casey, for coming on the show. And what's your website and podcast we can send people to?
Well, Debbie, this has been so much fun. Like I said, we've had so much positive feedback from the episode we did with you. So it was just great. So our company is called Boundless Body. Our website is myboundlessbody.com. And our podcast is called Boundless Body Radio. People can find us there. We're always happy to answer questions. Feel free to reach out to us on the website. There's ways that you can just click and message us and a message will come through. And we're just happy to help people and answer questions and whatever they need.
Good. Thanks so much.
Yeah, you're very welcome.
Thanks for listening to the Low Carb Athlete Podcast. If you have any questions, feedback, or topic suggestions, let us know on Facebook or at debbiepotts.net. You can help us to continue to grow by leaving a review on iTunes. Thanks again, and we'll see you next time.